Hello all, welcome to Crime Theory. In this video, I'm going to discuss what theory is and why it matters for crime and criminal justice. Theories are vital tools in criminology. They help us understand the criminal justice system and its actors. Theories describe what is, not what ought to be, and are generally neutral in nature. Theories can explain crime on a large scale, called macro, or at an individual level, called micro. Social sciences deal with human behavior, which is more probabilistic and less absolute than the physical and natural sciences purport to be. For a theory to be effective, it must be logical, be able to explain a broad range of crimes, be concise, and most importantly, be valid. It should also have practical applications and policy implications. While many theories share common traits, their differences are crucial in understanding the diverse views of crime and deviance they aim to explain. Let's review some key terms in crime theory. In simple terms, a theory is an explanation of something. For instance, routine activities theory explains that crime occurs when a motivated offender, a suitable target, and the absence of a capable guardian converge in time and space. Theory differs from ideology. Ideology is a set of beliefs explaining how things should be, while theory explains how things actually are. Ideology in the context of crime refers to a set of beliefs, values, and opinions about crime, its causes, and how it should be dealt with. It's more about a viewpoint or a perspective that is often influenced by political, social, or moral values. A theory, on the other hand, is a set of propositions or hypotheses that seek to explain why crime occurs or how criminal behavior is influenced. Theories are typically based on empirical evidence and are tested through scientific methods. For example, the ideology that harsher punishments deter crime is based on the belief that strict consequences are morally necessary and effective, whereas a theory that social economic factors influence crime rates is based on empirical evidence, analyzing the relationship between poverty, education, and criminal behavior. A good theory must have internal logical consistency. Logical internal consistency refers to the coherence and non-contradictory nature of a set of statements, principles, or propositions. In a logically consistent framework, no part of the system contradicts another part. That is, a theory should make logical sense and have consistent propositions. For example, let's say a theory suggests that low community engagement leads to higher crime rates. It maintains internal logical consistency if it consistently posits that increasing community engagement in various forms should correspondingly reduce crime without contradicting this principle in any of its propositions or explanations. Empirical validity is a measure of how well the results of a study or predictions of a theory support the conclusions that are drawn from it. It's about the extent to which the theory or the findings of a study accurately reflect or represent the real-world phenomena they're supposed to model or predict. A theory must have empirical validity, the most and crucial factor. That theory is supported by resident research evidence. Consider a crime theory suggesting a correlation between poverty and increased rates of petty theft in urban areas. To test its empirical validity, researchers conduct studies, gathering data on poverty and theft rates in various cities. Through statistical analysis, they examine whether higher poverty levels consistently lead to more petty theft. If the data repeatedly shows this correlation, the theory is considered empirically valid, and it is supported by research evidence reflecting real-world phenomena. However, if the correlation is inconsistent or heavily influenced by other variables, the theory's empirical validity would be weak, indicating the need for a revision. This process ensures that the theory is grounded in reality and is useful for informing crime prediction and prevention strategies. To be valid and ultimately useful, a theory must be able to be subjected to scientific research. That is, it must be testable. Testability refers to the extent to which a theory can be empirically tested or verified through observation and experimentation. It's a fundamental criterion for theory to be considered scientific. Consider a crime theory stating that a new community policing strategy reduces violent crime in urban areas. To test this theory, researchers would compare crime rates between neighborhoods with and without this policing strategy. This involves empirical methods like controlled experiments or observational studies. The theory is testable because it makes specific, observable predictions about crime rates, which can be empirically examined. If data consistently supports the theory's predictions, it is validated. If not, that theory may need revision. Testability ensures the theory's claims are empirically investigable. Does the appearance of one factor always or usually cause another? This is crucial in understanding the relationship between factors. Causality, in a general sense, refers to the relationship between cause and effect. It implies that one event, the cause, is responsible for the occurrence of another event, the effect. In the context of scientific theory, causality is used to explain why things happen and to predict the consequences of certain actions or events. The concept of causality can be observed in the patterns of crime. For example, a spike in unemployment, X, might lead to an increase in theft, Y, showcasing a cause and effect relationship. Probabilistic causality extends the concept of causality to situations where events are not deterministically linked, but rather are connected through probabilities. For example, probabilistic causality is observing that while not all unemployed individuals turn to theft, there's a higher likelihood of probability of such offenses among the unemployed. A good theory needs necessary and sufficient conditions. What conditions are essential for a particular effect to occur, and when is their presence enough to guarantee that effect? A necessary condition is something that must be present for a particular event or statement to be true, but on its own may not be enough to guarantee that event or statement. In other words, it's a condition without which the event cannot occur, but its presence alone does not automatically mean the event will occur. For example, having a motive for a crime is necessary for somebody to be considered a suspect, but having a motive alone does not automatically make that person the perpetrator. A sufficient condition, on the other hand, is one that, if met, ensures that the event or statement in question will occur or be true. However, it's not the only condition that can lead to the outcome. That is, other sets of conditions might also lead to the same result. For example, capturing clear video evidence of a person committing a crime is sufficient for establishing their guilt. But guilt can also be established through other means, such as eyewitness testimony or forensic evidence. Parsimony and scope are important concepts in the development and evaluation of crime theories. These refer to the simplicity of a theory and the extent of crime types it covers. Parsimony in crime theory refers to the simplicity of the theory in explaining criminal behavior. It's based on the principle of Occam's razor, which suggests that among competing hypotheses, the one with the fewest assumptions should be selected. In other words, a parsimonious crime theory would explain a wide range of criminal behaviors with a minimal number of assumptions or complex explanations. For example, a theory stating that economic deprivation leads to increased crime rates is parsimonious because it reduces complex assumptions. It uses that single socioeconomic factor to explain a wide range of criminal behavior. Scope in crime theory refers to the extent and range of phenomena or behaviors that a theory can explain or predict. A theory with a broad scope can explain a wide variety of criminal behaviors across different contexts and populations. A theory proposing that societal factors like poverty, education, and family structure collectively influence a range of criminal behaviors from petty theft to violent crime demonstrates broad scope by addressing multiple behaviors across diverse contexts. So I mentioned previously about macro and micro. In the context of crime theories, the terms macro and micro refer to different levels of analysis and focus. These perspectives help us in understanding the multifaceted nature of criminal behavior and the various factors that influence it. Each level offers a different lens through which crime can be examined and addressed. Macro-level crime theories focus on large-scale social, economic, and cultural influences on crime. These theories are often examine broad social trends, structural factors, and institutional aspects that influence crime rates and criminal behavior in a society, such as social structure and organization, cultural and normative factors, policy and legislation, and historical or societal trends. For example, social disorganization theory is a macro theory. This theory suggests that a community's level of organization or disorganization affects its crime rates. It posits that high crime rates are often found in areas with weakened social institutions like schools and families, poor neighborhood relationships, and economic deprivation. These factors can lead to a breakdown in social control and community cohesion, which in turn can increase crime. Micro-level crime theories, on the other hand, focus on individual-level factors that influence criminal behavior. These theories are concerned with the personal, psychological, and immediate situational aspects of crime, such as individual psychology and behavior, the immediate social environment, situational factors, or biological and genetic factors. An example of a micro-level crime theory is rational choice theory. This theory focuses on individual decision-making processes that precede criminal behavior. While macro and micro-level crime theories have distinct focuses, they are not mutually exclusive. An integrative approach that combines both perspectives can provide a more comprehensive understanding of crime. Such integration recognizes that broader social control, economic and cultural conditions, the macro level, create the context within individual choices and behaviors, the micro level, occur. By examining both levels, researchers and policymakers can develop more effective strategies for crime prevention and intervention. An example of this might be social control theory. So this could be considered an integrated theory because it acknowledges the role of societal structures and institutions in influencing individual behavior. It posits that strong social bonds and integration into society's key institutions like family, school, and work play a crucial role in preventing criminal behavior. This aspect reflects the macro level focus on societal organization and values that impact individual actions. At the same time, the theory delves into individual level factors by examining the strength and nature of personal relationships and individual commitments to societal norms and values. It considers how personal interactions and the immediate social environment can influence an individual's propensity to engage in criminal behavior. A good theory is not tautological. A tautology is a statement or theory that is circular or self-confirming, and as a result, offers no explanatory power or real insight into criminal behavior. It's a logical fallacy where the conclusion is inherently true based solely on the premises, regardless of external evidence or factors. For example, a tautological statement in crime theory might be something like, criminals commit crimes because they have criminal tendencies. This statement is tautological because it uses the concept of criminal tendencies to explain criminal behavior, but criminal tendencies are only defined by the presence of criminal behavior. As a result, the statement doesn't provide any real explanation or insight into why individuals commit crimes. It merely restates the fact in different terms. The issue with tautologies in crime theory is that they do not advance our understanding of criminal behavior or contribute to the development of effective interventions and policies. They merely restate the obvious in a way that seems explanatory, but actually isn't. To be valuable, theories in criminology need to identify specific, non-tautological factors or mechanisms that lead to criminal behavior. Another key term in crime theory is soft determinism. This is the idea that behavior is influenced, but not entirely determined, by various factors. Soft determinism blends elements of determinism and free will in understanding criminal behavior. Determinism is the idea that all events, including human actions, are ultimately determined by causes external to the will. Soft determinism, however, posits that while human behavior is influenced by external factors, individuals still possess a degree of free will that allows them to make choices. This concept suggests that criminal behavior may be influenced by various determinants, such as biological, psychological, social, and environmental factors, yet individuals retain the capacity for autonomous decision-making within these constraints. For example, an individual growing up in a high-crime neighborhood, an external factor, may be more inclined toward criminal behavior, but the choice to engage in or abstain from crime ultimately remains with the individual, demonstrating both the influence of environmental factors and the role of personal agency. Finally, theories of crime must ultimately be useful. The usefulness of crime theories lie in their ability to offer practical, empirically supported insights and strategies for reducing crime and improving the effectiveness of the criminal justice system. In the context of crime theories, usefulness refers to the practical and applicability and relevance of a theory in understanding, preventing, and addressing criminal behavior. A useful crime theory not only provides insights into the nature and causes of crime, but also aids in developing effective strategies for law enforcement, criminal justice policy, and social interventions. For example, broken windows theory suggests that visible signs of disorder and neglect in a community, like broken windows and graffiti and litter, can encourage further crime and antisocial behavior. Its practical application has been influential in urban policy strategies, leading to efforts to clean up neighborhoods, maintain public spaces, and address minor offenses promptly. This approach aims to create an environment of order and lawfulness, thereby deterring more serious crimes. Broken windows theory has been instrumental in shaping community policing and urban maintenance policies in many cities. Okay, that's all for today. But remember, understanding crime theory is not just an academic exercise. It's a tool for shaping a more just society. As we explore these theories, remember their role in guiding policies and practices within the criminal justice system. For more information and for resources, please refer to your class materials or the sources posted in the description. Stay curious and keep exploring.